you can remember such things, but we are going to be singing hymns today, so I hope you will sing. It must believe it's a great joy to be able to have music in church again, and Feast of the Assumption on the dawn with the choirs of angels to sing with Our Lady in Heaven seems like a very good place to start singing. So do please join in. Trust yourselves just to let go. You probably haven't sung for a very long time, but I'm sure your voices will all be fine for you. So just enjoy it, and that's where you will be. The rest of the mass will be as considered in the evening service. Sing the hymn number 185.
Thank you.
receive body and soul into the glory of heaven. We give thanks for Mary's perfect obedience to the will of God, rewarded in that act of her not suffering bodily corruption, but being received directly into the glory of heaven to be alongside her Son and her Saviour, he whom she bore in her womb. As we honour her today, let us pray that we may follow her path of obedience, that we may carry him in our hearts and reveal him to the waiting world as truly as she bore him in her womb. To prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries, first, let us call to mind and confess our sins. Lord, forgive us when we have failed to serve you. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, forgive us when we have failed to love you. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, forgive us when we have failed to proclaim you. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Its spring. So the Lord God will call to righteousness and praise to spring up before the nations. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Second reading. Hear me from the letter of Paul to the Galatians. When the fullness of time had come, God sent his Son, born of woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. And because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you no longer a slave but a child.
Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour, for he has looked with favour on the lowliness of his servant. Surely, from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We come to meet the risen Lord, who comes to us in word and in sacrament. In fact, the two are intertwined. The word of God is more than just the word which we proclaim and hear and read. The word made flesh who dwelt among us is Jesus Christ himself, who comes to us in this sacrament through the mystery of the incarnation, by which God, the fullness of God, is made into a human being in the womb of Mary. The place of Mary in our salvation is desperately important. And today is a celebration of her importance in the story of our salvation. The celebration of the grace and power of God in one human life, of what truly extraordinary and wonderful things the Lord can do in a life which is open, obedient, and receptive to him. It's a celebration of faith and trust, Mary's total faith in her Lord, the Lord who was her Saviour and who was also her son, her child. It is also a celebration today of our own faith in Jesus, the Word made flesh, who has, it is true, that Mary, who has promised that he is with us always, not just in the pages of history, not just in that one example of the incarnation 2,000 years ago, but is made incarnate in our lives day by day, if only we are open to him. Mary's openness, Mary's obedience, Mary's humility give us the perfect example of how we ought to be so open to Christ that he can enter our lives. And yet for many, Mary can seem an uncomfortable character. A lot of people see Marian devotion as something rather vulgar, not very English. It has to be said that some religious art does not help to counter this claim. I have seen some of the most hideous images of Our Lady, perhaps, and of any other saint, sometimes repeated complete with flashing halos and battery-operated all sorts of things, and beautiful plastic, rather tawdry things. Yes, sometimes the art doesn't help us to get to the true message of this girl of Nazareth, obedient to God's will, seeking to do what he wanted in order to make the Word made flesh appear here on earth through her ministry. But Mary is a very real character. That's where we get to the real person, the Maid of Nazareth. Someone real whose cooperation with God made possible our salvation. Without her cooperation, God could not have appeared as a human being in the way in which he did, in order to lead us back to our home in heaven. Luke's Gospel, from which we heard, opens with a great deal of attention to the Virgin Mary, and her destiny is revealed through the encounters with the angel Gabriel, her cousin Elizabeth, and with Simeon in the temple. Some of those images, of course, are present in our stained glass windows in the Lady Chapel, particularly those of the Visitation and of the Annunciation. In Our Lady, we see a unique place and role in God's purpose. The Incarnation is the very beginning of our redemption, of the indissoluble union of God coming alongside humanity in the one person of Christ. And Mary is the pivotal point of that relationship. There's no suggestion that she was forced to accept her role. Her agreement was spontaneous and sincere, and was her own. Her willing and complete yes to the call of God. Behold, she said, I am the handmaid of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. Here is something with which we can identify as we in our humanity, our fallen, sinful humanity, seek to discover the godlike in ourselves and in the world around us. Christian religion differs from many other religions in that the heart of the message is not found in our attempts to reach God. Rather, it is about the tale of God's eternal search for us. The bishop who ordained me as a deacon, Bishop David Jenkins of Durham, used to say, we all worry that we are not up to it. Don't worry, he said, God is down to it. That, for me, is something which has stayed a part of my devotion and an encouragement. Whenever we feel that we cannot reach to the heights of heaven, or indeed we cannot by our own efforts, we must always remember that we are not called to. God has already come to fetch us. Yes, we can't reach up to him, but he has reached down to us. So, as David Jenkins said, we're not up to it, but fret not. God is indeed down to it. So we find in Mary a real humanity which became a point of connection between us, our lives of confusion and muddle, and the Jesus of history, leading us to the God of heaven who calls us to our heavenly home. Secondly, Mary deepens our relationship with Jesus Christ. Mary is known as the Mother of God. It is a title that points the way to Christ. Mary is represented with the Christ Church, with the Christ Child, and is always seen pointing the observer to her Son. Very often, her hand is around him in such a way as to be making that gesture of pointing so that all who gaze on her are drawn to look at the child in her arms. A real reverence for the Virgin Mary, where she is drawn into our spirituality, will of necessity deepen our understanding.
understanding of the mystery of the Incarnation, because through it we will always be pointed to her Son and her Saviour and ours. Thirdly, Mary shows us the pattern of faith. In her cooperation with God, in living with her Son, who was also her Lord and Saviour, she points the way of discipleship. Earthly emotions caught up with the divine, God in the everyday. Yes, she was his follower, she was his disciple, but she was too his mother. From the very beginning, Mary was introduced to the riddle of salvation, that the one in whom the world, for whom the world had waited and longed for, would come, but that his triumph would be found in apparent failure, reversing the pattern and bringing life out of death. It is this eternal paradox that calls our attention today, giving substance to our devotion to Mary and making sense of our doctrine. It may all seem too much, and indeed it is too much for our human minds to get around. But as Bishop David Jenkins said, we don't need to worry about that. We don't need to worry that we're not up to it, because God is down to it. So we may ask, as Mary asked of the angel, how can these things be? And the angel will reply to us as the angel replied to Mary: with God, nothing shall be impossible. Thanks be to God. Amen. So let us declare our faith in the living God, as together we say, we believe
in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from Mary, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In the power of that Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father, saying, Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For the peace of the world, for a spirit of goodwill between nations, for is that like our Queen and all who are set in authority, that righteousness may dwell in our lands. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For your Church in its holiness, that its love for the world might be deepened, its faith strengthened, and its unity revealed. for this diocese of London, for Sarah, our bishop, and for Pete, bishop of Willesden. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously
for our families and friends, for those who love us and support us in our daily lives, for this church and community, and for all who live, work, or visit here. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For your love and healing for all who are suffering, remembering Simon, Dot, Brenda, Irene, Robert, Natalia, Jonathan, Wendy, Lucy, Rose, Adam, Barbara, Ross, Collins, and Silvia, Christina, Marie, Jamie, Danny, Patos, Barbara, Vicky, Julie, Katie, Francis, Karen, Maggie, Anna, and Snowa. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
For those who have died, Edison, Harvey, Carlo, Justin, Collard, recently departed, and Elsie Woods, Augustine, Buckhill Priest, Thomas Burrows, Vivian Metro, Ellen Rees, and Luke Knight, whose universities are at this time. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Uniting our prayers with those of Our Lady and all the saints, let us pray that we may share with them the abiding crown of glory. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
O God, whose will it is that all should find salvation and come to know the truth, receive our prayers through him who sacrificed himself to win freedom for all humanity, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, where you live and reign for ever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of that peace. We sing hymn number 186.
Thank you.
our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
Lord, accept the sacrifice we offer for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his church.
Look upon us in mercy and not in judgment, O Lord, draw us from hatred to love and make the frailty of our prayers a dwelling place for your glory through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, be with you. Same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. We offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup. We thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, Christ our Lord, by heaven and with heaven and in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty God, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Taught by our Saviour's command and formed by the word of God, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
God Most High, whose hand made all the Word made flesh. We thank you that in this sacrament of our redemption, you visit us with your Holy Spirit and overshadow us by your power. Strengthen us to walk with Mary the joyful path of obedience, and so to bring forth the fruits of holiness through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Just a couple of notices. Very good to have Father Philip and Father Ayoob concelebrating here today. Over the next couple of weeks, when I'm taking some time off, they will be helping in the celebration of the Mass and preaching. I'm enormously grateful to you, Fathers, for that. And it's very good to know that we are a team together. Thank you. There will be no Saturday Masses for the rest of the month of August. Saturday Mass resumes on the 4th of September at 12:30. And the church will be closed on Thursday the 26th for a wedding. And so there will be no Mass at 12:30 on that day. And also there will be no Mass on Bank Holiday Monday, which is the 30th of August. They, I think, are all of the necessary notices regarding times. I published the vows of marriage between Emily Rose Atkins of the parish of St. Matthew Euston and Alex Daniel John Elkins, also of the parish of St. Matthew Euston. These are for the second time of asking. If any of you know cause or just impediment why these persons may not lawfully be joined together in holy matrimony, you are to declare it. We continue to pray for Emily and Alex as they prepare for their wedding and for married life together. We sing our final hymn, which is number 161.
Thank you.
the